Almost. Let's all stand. You may be seated. My dear friends, in dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory someday. And as in baptism, Carol put on Christ, so is in Christ, may she be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed to us, but we know that when he appears, we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also." My dear friends, we gather here this afternoon to praise our God, and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Carol Ann Morris. We come together in grief, acknowledging that we have human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Let us all pray. Eternal God, We praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we praise you for Carol Morris, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let your perpetual light shine upon them, and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them. In the joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens. And we pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, part of our faith, we find great comfort in the Word of God, because the Word of God brings us truth. And in that truth, we understand Him better, and we understand His promises better. So as a part of the service, I'd like to read a few select readings out of the Old Testament. In Psalm 130, David writes, "Out of the depths I cry unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my cry. Let thy ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If thou, Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word do I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is great mercy, and with him is plenteous redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all her sins." Isaiah, the prophet, wrote these words when he says, "Have you not known and have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint, nor does he grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youth will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." One of the great psalms that many of us grew up learning is Psalm 23. So I invite you to join with me in the reading of Psalm 23. It's inside your bulletin if you would like to use that to follow along. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in the green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me, and in the presence of my enemies, thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen." And so is the reading of God's holy word from the Old Testament. At this time, we have a selected song by Casting Crowns entitled "Scars in Heaven."
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter, Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing. And they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven from the hands that hold you now. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. All the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.
In the New Testament, there's a lot to be said on the subject of death. It's not a very comfortable subject for any of us to face or to talk about. Many times we'll go the other direction when we have to face it. Maybe one of the great fears that many of us still have, whether we admit it or not, when we sit in a church like we are here, we're grieving because we lost somebody that we love. Death is hard to face. It is hard. But it makes us face ourselves at the same time, because we realize just as we mourn the passing of Carol, someday someone will mourn our passing. And so Jesus understood this. He understood our human condition. Because, see, God became human, and he walked among us. He didn't remain on the throne far away. He came and he walked among us, and he too would die someday. His death, though, was different. His death was one that would end with a resurrection 3 days later. His death was when he took your and my sin, all of our sins, whether you accept it or reject it, he still took your sins on a cross, and he bled to wash away the ugliness of sin in our hearts and lives. It's the most wonderful love story in all of history, is the love of our Lord Jesus, that he would give himself a perfect vessel, one who did not sin, became sin, so that you and I could live. That includes all of us, every one of us. And so how can we not look to the New Testament as a part of our understanding of life and death? John on the Isle of Patmos, he was the one apostle who was not put to death. He spent his rest of his life isolated, alone, exiled on an island called Patmos. It was there that he received the revelation from God, from Christ himself. And he sat down and he wrote. And that's what we have now in the Bible called the Book of Revelation. The Apostle John wrote those words. And so I want to read a few of the words that he wrote. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy, and they're true." Then he said, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit all these things. I will be their God, and they will be my children." The Apostle Paul wrote in his letter to the people of Rome, he wrote these words when he said, "There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from sin and of death. In the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through the Spirit that dwells in you. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him." I want you to listen to this, because I know Carol, for the last several years, had a lot of her struggles. It's been a hard life for her, especially in the last several years. "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the future glory that is going to be revealed to us." Is it a powerful statement? Because it gives us all hope that God does understand. He knows exactly everything. He knows our suffering. We know the suffering of our dear friend, but now she's been set free. She's been healed, completely, totally healed, and she is in the presence of a loving Jesus. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." Our Lord and Savior has prepared a place for us. It's in glory, folks. It's not like this earth. It doesn't have the troubles. It doesn't have the wars and the suffering or the diseases. It is perfect in every way. And He waits for those who love Him. I believe Carol loved Him. I do. And so is the reading of God's holy word. My friends, at this time, we're going to share maybe some personal comments. Maybe you have a testimonial and that you would like to share about Carol with everyone. This is just one of those times where you just, we have a microphone for those that are going to that would like to speak out there, mainly because we're live. This is live casting. And so that all of the people that are watching this elsewhere can share in it also. Let me give it to you.
Hi, I'm Carol's oldest daughter, Kimberly. And my mom was super unique, so my memory is going to be unique too. I'm just going to read it. I don't think I could do it any other way. So I'm going to tell you the memories of Mom and her popcorn. My earliest memories of Mom is from when I was 3 or 4 years old. It was my birthday. And I can vividly remember us sitting there on the couch across the street in a trailer over there with a bowl of popcorn watching the Peanuts show. And she had tucked me into bed, and I remember that from being very little. She always tucked me into bed, wished me well night, and always said, "I love you." When I was in early elementary, she would always pack these little bags of popcorn and put in my lunchbox, and there would always be a note in there. "Have a good day. Don't let somebody bother you." It was always something to encourage me. She wanted to make sure I knew I had someone on my side. When I had my first heartbreak, she popped a huge bowl of popcorn, and we sat out on the swing. She let me cry and cry forever, and I'll never forget these words. She said, "You are worth so much more. Never settle for less." And I didn't. When I got pregnant with my first child, she brought back the tradition. She packed me little popcorn bags and put them in the car and would always tell me, "It's okay. You got this. You're going to be a great mom." She was right. She was a good example. When life got hard and she let me move home, because, you know, we all do that now, she talked to me, and we would always eat popcorn, and through these popcorn conversations, she gave me strength to keep going on, and she is the reason I am who I am today. By our last conversation, she was in a nursing home. Thankfully, somebody taught her how to use FaceTime. And so I was so excited because I was on my way to Jewel's house because she was having the baby the next day, and we were talking, and she was just so excited. She loved life. She was so excited, and she was fixed to be a great grandmother, and pure joy on her face. And of course, she was eating popcorn and asked me if I could bring her some next Friday. But throughout my whole life, popcorn and Mom were two things together. It was her way, because she had a hard time talking sometimes. But she could sit down with popcorn, and we could talk, and we could eat. And it was always these deep conversations that we shared our love, our passions, and she was able to be herself. In my lasting memories of Mom, they're just very simple. She was a complicated woman, yet so passionate. She knew her worth. She never waned in her support and love for her family. She settled all her old differences. She fell in love again with Ron. And she always stood up to adversity, even when there were times when it was unbearable. Carol was a very unique angel in this world, and I'm proud to be her daughter.
Thank you. God bless you. Anyone else? Anybody would like to share a few words? Anyone at all? Thank you for that. She did a good job, by the way. You know, the hymn Amazing Grace is one of those hymns that I know a lot of people listen to, and it's one of the hymns that we all know. And so before I share a few words, let's all stand and let's sing the first, third, and the last verse of Amazing Grace. It should be up on the screen for you. I can tell you where Carol used to sit when she would come to church was back here toward the back, almost all the way at the back, on the left side. I can also tell you that her comments as she would be leaving, as I was trying to sort of get a feel if the sermon made a difference or not, she was very quiet. So I used to think, well, maybe it wasn't so good. But she came back, so I was thinking, maybe it wasn't as bad as I thought. She was a quiet-spoken lady, very humble lady. There was a mission that she used to participate in our church. Did you know that? She did. And I see the people that introduced her to that mission, and that's where I got to know her the best. I don't know her as well as all of you, obviously. But we would sit. She was quiet, spoken, but she would speak. And then those Saturday mornings at times, I would sit there and we would talk back and forth. And I don't know what it was, but God sort of had a way of putting us together, whether she was inside or outside. I would find that place close by. And we would just have cordial conversation. You know, her spirit is a spirit of genuine humility. Oh, I'm sure she fought her demons. We all fight our demons, don't we? Every one of us. But there was a sense of kindness in her. And I could see that. A gentle spirit, a gentle soul. You know, I think there's a special place in heaven for people like that. We have so many brash people that are out making lots of noise in this world. And usually it's those quiet ones that you really find an inner strength, things that you can't put to words, but yet they're there and they're real. And I think that's why you love her so. Not only the smile that she would have, but also that inner peace that she could find. It wasn't always easy. Nothing in this world is. But I do believe this is a woman that was met by an angel not long ago and carried from the deathbed to a risen Jesus, and now has been healed of all the apprehensions she might have had, all the questions that might have been in her soul are being answered. Because it is people just like this that our Lord came to save and redeem and to make whole. And whether it's done here on this earth or whether it's done in heaven, it is a wonderful thing what God does. Many times it begins here, and that's where it ends up, is in heaven. It's not easy, my friends. I assure you, I'm with you. I have lost in my life. I have lost good friends and family to the deathbed, and I know it's difficult. There's not really words to say that can make it all better, because we're human beings. See, we have not seen that place yet. We have not gone there. We still are here, fighting the battles, fighting our demons, trying to find truth somewhere in life. I have found that that truth is in Jesus Christ. He even told us, "I am the way, and I am the truth and the life, that no one will come to the Father but through himself. See, that's how we find it. Whether you have the faith of a mustard seed or have the faith of a giant tree, we find it in Jesus, the resurrected Lord. He is our Savior. He came to redeem us. He came to reconcile us with the Father because of our sin. He hasn't given up on you, and He won't. I hope you haven't given up on Him. I hope you're seeking Him to find that peace. There were three people in Jesus' life that were a really good friend of His. Well, He had His disciples who were closest to Him, but these were three that He would go to their home on occasion and stay, and they would fix meals and have those talks, you know, you have with close friends. One's name was Mary, and the other's name was Martha. And then their brother's name was Lazarus. I think maybe you recognize those names. But if not, let me tell you a little bit about those people. They were very close to Christ. They knew that if they ever called on Him, He would come running as quickly as He could. But there was a time when Lazarus got really sick, and he actually was dying. And so Martha and Mary called on Jesus, "Please come. We want You to come and heal him of this sickness like You've healed so many others." But Jesus was delayed 2 days, and Lazarus died. They put Him in a tomb. And as Jesus finally did approach the town where they lived, they saw Him coming, and Martha came out and she says, "If You had only been here." How many have got those "if You had only" things in your life? I call them the woulda, shoulda, couldas. I wish I'd done this. I wish I'd have said that. I wish I'd have been there when. We all go through it, especially when someone dies. If I could have just only made one more visit, if I'd have just made that phone call when I almost did but didn't, if I'd only been a better friend. We go through that. It's haunting when we do that to ourselves. And so, Martha and Mary, if you would have only been here, if you'd have just been 2 days earlier, then our brother would not have died. The amazing thing about this story is Jesus did not immediately go into raise them from the dead mode. He didn't. What was it that he did? He stood there with her and he wept, the Bible tells us. He cried. Why would he cry? Why would the Jesus that knew that he could raise him from the dead and was going to stand there and cry? The reason is because it's simple. He lost a friend. He lost a close friend to death. See, death takes no prisoners. It doesn't release any anyway. We all come to that place in our life where we're going to die. It's a reality. And that reality touched him just like it touches you and I. He understood then, and he understands now. The woulda, coulda, shouldas. He understands the fear and the hurt, that unnamed pain that reaches deep into the soul and touches our hearts and breaks it. And we can't get a grip. When you're driving down the road and you feel that you couldn't cry anymore, and then all of a sudden the tears come back and you weren't even thinking about it, and you just have to pull off on the side and cry it out. He understands that. Death is hard, but our Lord is greater. Because see, that day he walked down to that tomb, and there he walked in, and he said, "Lazarus, come forth." And he came out of the tomb. It's a beautiful resurrection story. And Jesus said to Mary, "Who do you say that I am?" She says, "You are the resurrection and the life." And that's exactly who he is. Carol has figured that out. Even though she looks through the mirror dimly now, but now she can see him face to face. Even though when she was on this earth, she only knows in part, but now she knows fully as she is fully known. See, my dear friends, it's hard for us to understand it, I know. But she has been made whole. She has been healed. It's like John said, there'll be no more tears, no more sorrow, no more mourning and grief, no more cancers or diseases. They've all passed away, and we've been made whole. Makes you want to shout amen, doesn't it? It does. We have a good God in a bad world. We have a good Lord who forgives and restores. And if you have even the faith as small as a mustard seed, he can move the mountains in your life and make you whole. That's a promise, and it's the truth. Carol is now no longer fighting those battles. Her demons are in hell now. And she's in heaven. And she's been set free. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us all pray. Loving Jesus, in this time right now, we come to you because we know that you are our Lord and our King. You are the Master. You are the Savior of the world. And Lord, as this family has released Carol into your care, I pray that your Holy Spirit will come and give comfort to their homes and their hearts, to encourage their faith, to strengthen them in the days ahead, that they can do the things in their life that need to be done, that they can reconcile with those whom they might harbor ill will, that those areas of their life that need to be healed, they will find true peace. We thank you, Lord, that you're that kind of God. And on this sacred day, we come to you humbly and we say, thank you for loving us so. I thank you for the life of Carol Morse and all that means to so many different people in so many different ways. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, my friends, we're going to go at the direction of the funeral directors, and we will follow each other over to the cemetery where we'll have the committal service. Afterwards, then we'll come back to the church. There is refreshments for family that's been provided for you. You might want to come and just speak if you've come to pay your respects. Speak to the family at that time also. So, let's all stand. Okay.